风尘泌尿学会关心您。
Of the recent data. Oh, this is my summary slide. We have to go back. And the recent updates from the genitourinary ESCO meeting, which for the first time showed the data of the Keynote 426 study, which are very impressive. So these are briefly my disclosures, and that's what I'm going to talk about. I will start with the current guideline recommendations. I will give you an update of the CheckMate 214 study, which compared Nivo plus Ipi to sunitinib, and there was a minimum 30 months follow-up presented at ASCO GU. Then I will talk about IO-TKI combinations in renal cell carcinoma, which are Pembro plus Axi, very recently published. Javelin has already been published at ESMO, and there was an update at ASCO GU, and I will also briefly touch the EMOTION 151 trial. Furthermore, there was an interesting study on non-clear cell RCC, Keynote 427, and I will provide you with that data. And finally, I will show you the ongoing clinical trials in clear cell RCC. So this is the current guideline by our European Association of Urology. And as you can see, we still have here for favorable risk disease, sunitinib or pazopanib, and in intermediate and poor risk patients, we have the strong recommendation in the moment for Nivo plus Ipi. However, after the recent GU-ESCO, this guideline will be updated, or has to be updated, because when these new combinations are approved, we will have a backbone of PD-1 immune checkpoint inhibition, I think, for most of our patients in the frontline setting. So these are the data which led to the recommendation of Nivo plus Ipi for intermediate and poor-risk patients in the frontline setting. CheckMate 214 was a study which randomized roughly 1,100 patients which were treatment naive with metastatic clear cell RCC with measurable disease and good performance status. They were randomized to receive either 4 doses of Nivo plus Ipi followed by Nivo maintenance or sunitinib in the standard regimen. The co-primary endpoints were PFS, OS, and objective response rate, and these are the outcome parameters with the minimum 30 months of follow-up, which were presented at ASCO last week. As you can see, there was a significant improvement in overall in objective response rate, 42% compared to 29%, and of note, this included 11.3% of complete remission, so a very high complete remission rate. However, you have to be aware that compared to the data published earlier, this is now investigator assessment, not independent review. Although the median PFS was numerically similar, there was a significant improvement, so the curve separated later after reaching the median, and the hazard ratio was 0.77, and there was a significant improvement in overall survival, which was confirmed, so initially it was 0.63, now it's 0.66. These are the curves from the initial publication in April last year in the New England Journal of Medicine, and on the left side you see the progression-free survival based on biomarker assessment. It appears that patients who were PD-L1 negative did not have an improvement in PFS, while there was a large difference with a hazard ratio of 0.48 in the PD-L1 positive tumors. How did this translate into the overall survival, which were published in the supplement of this publication only. So both groups did benefit. Patients who were PD-L1 positive with a hazard ratio of 0.45, while patients which were PD-L1 negative had a significant improvement with a hazard ratio of 0.73, so not as much as the PD-L1 positive patients. Also, the good risk group, so what I said before was restricted to patients with intermediate and poor risk. The good risk group was updated, and now there's no significant difference between Nivo plus Ipi and sunitinib with regard to objective response, progression-free survival, and overall survival. However, everything is numerically better with sunitinib alone. No difference in overall survival. The median is not reached, so there's a lot of incomplete or not enough, not long enough follow-up in the moment. These are the side effects, in general, I think we can say that the toxicity between an IO therapy alone and a TKI is completely different. On this side, you have chronic toxicity. On this side, the patients may have an immune-related adverse event. Regarding the chronic toxicity, only rash and pruritus is more frequent in patients who received Nivo plus Ipi. All other adverse events are more frequent with sunitinib. These are the immune-mediated adverse events. You might know these events from PD-1 monotherapy. However, there are some super additive effects if you apply Nivo plus Ipi. As you can see here, the number of grade 3-4 events, which I would say is for a PD-1 immune checkpoint inhibitor between 6% and 8%. And you can see here from the numbers, grade 3-4 events, this is much higher. 60% of the patients received corticosteroids at some time during the treatment, 35% received high-dose corticosteroids at some time during this trial. And I would like to share this case with you because I think this case very nicely shows the advantages but also the risks of this combination therapy. This was a 45-year-old lady which presented with this large kidney mass with involvement of the vena cava. The tumor was initially resected, and at that time she had already multiple pulmonary mets and two liver mets. And after the surgery, we put her on CheckMate 214, and at that time she had, this is only one, she had multiple pulmonary mets and these two liver mets. And we started in August 2015 with Nivo plus Ipi. And after three dosings, so after 9 weeks, she had an increase in liver enzymes, which equaled a grade 2 toxicity. We delayed the next dose, but when she came back after a few days, she had already a 22-fold increase in transaminases, which equaled a grade 4 toxicity. She had no symptoms, but due to this toxicity, we had to stop treatment after these three combination dosings. We started systemic steroids, and you can see here what happened. Here she had the increase in liver enzymes. We started corticosteroids, and then we tapered it after it has normalized to grade 1, and everything went fine, but we had to stop treatment permanently. This is the situation at baseline, and this is the situation 5 months after discontinuation of therapy. The pulmonary mets were not present, and you could see something from the liver mets. And on the next slide, I show you again the baseline regarding the liver with the two liver mets coming up here. And on the right side, you see the current follow-up now. So she received only three dosings. She had a severe toxicity. We had to stop, and now she's almost 3.5 years without any therapy and without any cancer. Let's move on to the new data with the IO-TKI combinations. and I will start with Keynote 426, which randomized 860 patients with a newly diagnosed or recurrent metastatic clear cell carcinoma without prior systemic therapy. The patients were randomized to receive either Pembro plus Axi in 5 mg dose or sunitinib in the standard dose. The co-primary endpoints were overall survival and progression-free survival, and objective response was the key secondary endpoint. These are the baseline characteristics of the patients. You see here the IMDC risk category, and in this trial there was a little bit higher rate compared to other trials of favorable risk patients, with roughly 31%, intermediate risk 55%. So this is a little bit more compared to the Javelin trial I will show later, and compared to the Levo plus Ipi trial. This is the primary endpoint overall survival, which showed a significant improvement with Pembro plus Axi with a hazard ratio of 0.53, so really a very large improvement which was seen here. And this was among all key subgroups. Of note, here's the IMDC risk categories. Patients with a favorable risk tended to have not as good results as patients with poor risk, according to IMDC. No big difference between PD-L1 positive and negative tumors with regard to overall survival. This is the secondary, co-primary endpoint PFS. Again, significant improvement with Pembro plus Axi, with a hazard ratio of 0.69. And this was, again, roughly the same in all key endpoints. Again, you see that favorable risk patients did not as good as the poor risk patients. They did benefit, obviously, most. And here there appears to be a small difference between PD-L1 positive and negative tumors. The PD-L1 negative tumors had a hazard ratio of 0.87 compared to 0.62 for the PD-L1 positive tumors. This is objective response, and when you remember the phase 2 data, which was presented on the combination of Pembro plus Axi, I think it was most impressive that you have very low rate of intrinsic resistance. Almost 60% of patients had an objective response. Complete response rate was not as high as with Nivo plus Ipi. However, it was 6%, and I think it's important to note that only 11% of the patients had progressive disease as best objective response. These are the subsequent therapies, and I think it's important to discuss what will we give next after someone has received a very effective VEGFR TKI in the frontline, like Axi, and a PD-1 antibody. And as you see, in the Pembro plus Axi arm, most of the patients received a VEGFR inhibitor as the subsequent therapy. This is the summary of adverse events, and as I already mentioned, here we have a TKI, so we have some kind of chronic toxicity. However, this led to discontinuation of both Pembro plus Axi in 11% of the patients. If you compare that with Nivo Ipi, there were more than 20% of the patients who had to stop treatment at some time for immune-related adverse events or other side effects. These are the treatment-related adverse events in comparison, and as you can see, overall, the combination of Pembro plus Axi, there seems to be no supra-additive effects or not a very much increased toxicity, with the exception of liver toxicity, a little bit higher increase and more severe increase in liver enzymes, and also dysphonia appears to be a little bit more frequent compared to the sunitinib group. These are the adverse events of interest, so the immune-related adverse events. And as you can see here, this is obviously more frequent with the combination compared to sunitinib alone for any grade and for grade 3 to 5. But if you look at the numbers here, I think this is the typical PD-1 immune checkpoint inhibitor toxicity. There appears to be no super additive effect in this combination, so we see all the typical side effects we know from PD-1 monotherapy. Now let's move on to the Javelin renal trial. This is again the same patient population. 886 patients were randomized to receive the PD-L1 antibody Avelumab and combined with axitinib 5 milligrams again, compared to sunitinib as the standard arm. And these are the key baseline characteristics. Here's the IMDC risk group. And as I said, the number of patients in the favorable risk group were a little bit smaller, more patients in the intermediate risk group in this trial. And the key primary endpoints were here PFS and OS in the PD-L1 positive group. This is the overall population, very similar to the PD-L1 positive group. This is the primary endpoint PFS in the PD-L1 positive group, and this was significantly improved with a hazard ratio of 0.61 for Avelumab and axitinib compared to sunitinib. And this is the other co-primary endpoint. This is median overall survival, again in the PD-L1 positive population. However, it did not meet statistical significance, at least at this time point. This slide again summarizes the efficacy data of Javelin Renal 101. This is the PD-L1 positive group. Objective responses very much comparable to the Pembro plus Axi trial, a little bit less if you consider the overall population, so it's 51%. With Pembro plus Axi it was 59%, but as I said, the combination of the overall population is a little bit different. So in general, I would say the overall population is not much different from the PD-L1 positive group. However, this data was updated at GEO-ASCO, and here you see some subgroup analysis from this trial, first of all by IMDC risk group. And this is a bit different picture. This refers to PFS, a bit different picture compared to what we saw with Pembro plus Axi. You remember the favorable risk group did not as well as the poor risk group. Here it's a bit different. Favorable risk appears to be about the same as poor risk, while the intermediate risk does a little bit worse, although the numbers getting small here. So we will see how this turns out with longer follow-up. This is by biomarker, PD-L1 status, and other factors. As you can see here, patients who were PD-L1 positive with a hazard ratio of 0.63 did benefit more compared to those who were PD-L1 negative with a hazard ratio of 0.80. However, again, the numbers are small and the follow-up is limited at this time point, so we have to wait for longer follow-up of this trial. Again, this is the subsequent anti-cancer therapy. Patients received an effective VEGFR TKI in the frontline and a PD-1 antibody. So what to give next? So in this population, patients received most frequently in the Avelumab plus Axi group cabozantinib or other TKI. Some even received other immune checkpoint inhibitors. And this is the progression-free survival 2. So the PFS for the next line of therapy. And I think this is a bit surprising with a hazard ratio of 0.56. The PFS2 is still improved in the Avelumab plus axitinib group. we can speculate that this may be some long-term effect of the PD-L1 antibody given in the frontline setting. And finally, regarding the combination of PD-1 checkpoint inhibitors and VEGF-targeted therapy, I would like to share with you the data of EMOTION-151, which was already presented about 1 year ago at ASCO GU 2018. This is the combination of the PD-L1 antibody atezolizumab with bevacizumab, an anti-VEGF antibody. Patients were randomized to receive this combination compared to sunitinib. You see again the baseline characteristics, and the primary endpoint was based on, again, PD-L1 expression, PFS and OS in the ITT population, where the primary outcome measures. This is the progression-free survival in PD-L1 positive group, and this was based on investigator assessment with a hazard ratio of 0.74. This was significantly improved for the combination, and these then is the PFS and objective response by independent review. And by independent review, you see on the left side, this was not anymore statistically significant. This is the overall survival, again, not significant in the ITT population at that time point, so we had to wait for longer follow-up. However, Roche has obviously asked for approval of this combination, at least to the EMA, and as you could read on the EMA webpage, this application was withdrawn after another interim analysis of OS, an unplanned interim analysis of OS has been performed, and this was obviously negative. So Roche has withdrawn the application at this moment and will wait for the final overall survival analysis. So this combination is, at least in the moment, not to come. Now let's move on to another not unfrequent situation. Roughly 15%, I would say, of renal cell carcinomas are non-clear cell, at least in my country. And let's have a look to KEYNOTE-427, which included two cohorts, the clear cell RCC cohort, which was the basis for KEYNOTE-426, which I just showed you. And there was cohort B, which included patients with non-clear cell RCC, 165 patients, which received pembrolizumab as the frontline treatment. The primary endpoint was objective response, and the data were shown just a week ago at GU ASCO by McDermott. And this is the waterfall diagram. As you can see, a little bit more than half of the patients experienced at least some reduction in tumor burden, 12% reduction in tumor burden, more than 80%. And this is by different non-clear cell subgroups. These are papillary tumors with an objective response rate of 25%, 4% complete responses. Chromophobe does not as good, but has a relatively high number of complete responses. If it's working, and the unclassified have an objective response rate of 35%. This is the analysis based on IMDC subgroup, and as you can see, favorable and intermediate and poorest, they have about the same, I would say, objective response rate. However, in the favorable risk group, relatively high complete remission rate has been seen. This is the analysis by CPS score, so by PD-L1 expression. For those who are positive, the chance of getting a response was 1 out of 3, so very good, 10% in the CPS negative risk group. So what other combinations are analyzed in the moment? We have this summarizes the phase 1b and phase 2 data of different antibody and VEGFR-TKI combinations. We have just seen the data for these two combinations, however, others are going to be analyzed. This is Pembro plus Lenva, Nivo and Tivozanib. Here you see the phase 2 data, which is very similar, only Atezo plus Beva, where I just mentioned the withdrawal of the application has a lower objective response rate. This, for example, is Pembro plus Lenvatinib, another very effective VEGFR TKI, and you see again very high response rates and very low rate of intrinsic resistance. So we may look forward what the ongoing phase 2 trial will show. So this slide shows the ongoing and not fully reported phase 3 trials. Javelin has been reported with regard to the endpoint PFS. OS is still pending. Another trial is currently recruiting, or just finished recruitment, is Nivo plus Cabo. Primary endpoint is progression-free survival. CLEAR analyzes Lenvatinib plus Pembro, and also as another arm, Everolimus and Lenvatinib. Primary endpoint is PFS, and KEYNOTE-426 has just been reported and met the co-primary endpoints, PFS and overall survival. So with this slide, I would like to summarize the most recent data on renal cell carcinoma. As I said, I think from now on, as when the drugs or the combinations are approved, we will have a PD-1 immune checkpoint inhibitor as backbone of therapy in the frontline setting. Nivo plus Ipi has shown an overall survival benefit in the intermediate and poorest patients. What we see are long-term remissions. I think the toxicity profile is still favorable, although we have more frequent immune-related adverse events with the combination and some super additive effects compared to a PD-1 directed monotherapy. The objective response rate is, I would say, moderate, with roughly 40%, not as high as with a PD-1 TKI combination. However, we have a high complete remission rate. The PD-L1 positive patients benefit most. I told you that the complete response rate was 11%. If you look at the initial publication, it was 9% with a short follow-up. And in those patients, when the PD-L1 positive group had even a complete response rate of 16%, so maybe PD-L1 will be an important marker in the future, also in renal cell carcinoma. With regard to the VEGFR TKI and PD-1 inhibition combinations, we see a very high objective response rates or low rate of intrinsic resistance, which I think is a benefit for these combinations. We have a known toxicity profiles of both drugs, the PD-1 antibody and the VEGFR TKI. However, we have a chronic toxicity due to the application of a TKI. Axitinib plus Pembro has an proven OS, PFS and objective response rate benefit in all risk groups. Axitinib plus avelumab has no proven overall survival benefit so far, so we will see how it turns out on the long run. What we don't know is whether we will see long-term remissions with these combinations, as we see with Nivo plus Ipi. Longer follow-up is obviously needed. And with regard to bevacizumab and atezolizumab, there was a PFS benefit, but only in the investigator assessment, not in the independent review committee. So this data is not so impressive. The objective response rate is much lower compared to the combinations with the VEGFR TKI. I would say this is because the anti-VEGF antibody is not as effective as a TKI, and overall survival data is still missing. So we will see how this study turns out with regard to OS on the long run. So that's my summary on the recent advances in RCC. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you for Professor Green's nice talk, and we think we have learned a lot from your talk. So now we are moving to the Q&A session. So if any questions from the audience, please raise your hand. Dr. Zhang.
Thank you, Professor. We know, as you reported, that right now we have IO-IO combination and the IO-DDR combination to for the first-line therapy. But the mechanism are actually quite different. And how do you see the difference based on the mechanism of action? And because the results are also quite different, because IO-IO combination, they show almost survival benefit, but progression free is not so promising. But the IO-DDR, especially the treatment of pembrolizumab, they show both PFS overall survival or objective response rate, and across this group. So how do you interpret these two different states of the mechanical action?
Well, I think it's difficult to interpret this based on the mechanism of action. I think immunotherapy usually takes a little bit longer to work, and while the TKI has a very the reaction to the TKI is very prompt. I think that the combination of Nivo plus Ipi gives a very sustained immune response. So this may lead to the long-term remissions we saw in that trial. However, as you mentioned, the benefit on the short term may be on the side of the TKI anti-PD-1 combination. Obviously, both combinations have a lot of benefits, and I think it will be our task to figure out which is the right patient for the right treatment, and this may be different with regard what we expect from treatment. So for a younger patient, the chance of a complete response may be more important. For patients with a high tumor burden, the low intrinsic resistance rate may be important. I think it will be the task of the next months and years to find out which is the right combination for the right patient.
And so we can say that we came into an era of embarrassment of riches. So,
yeah, definitely.
So which one is better? I think we meant to be answered. And if you report on Keynote 47, the cohort 2 for non-clear cell. But the cohort 1 also show a promising result with Pembro alone in the clear cell. So what do you see? What do you think of the PD-1 monotherapy, the role of IO monotherapy in the first line therapy?
Yeah, well, it's actually in the cohort A, the objective response was about 40%, so it was about the same as what we saw with Nivo plus Ipi. The data is still not very mature because the follow-up is very short, so we don't know the PFS. If you do a cross-study comparison, which you should not do, the PFS is not as long with Nivo plus Ipi, supporting what I said, that the long-term effects of this combination therapy may be, this is an important effect of the combination therapy, that you see long-term remissions. The data is promising, however, I don't think this will not lead to any approval because it's only a phase 2 trial. What I'm currently doing in a clinical trial is a sequential approach where we start with the PD-1 antibody, actually Nivo, and we apply it for 16 weeks, because after that time, roughly 75% of the responses have occurred with the PD-1 antibody in renal cell carcinoma. And for those patients who have stable disease or are still progressing, we apply Nivo plus Ipi. So this gives the chance for lower toxicity for those patients who respond, and increases the chance, that's the idea, increases the chance of a long-term remission for those who do not respond within that time frame. So we use a sequential approach. The trial is called TITAN-RCC, and I hope I will present the data at ESMO next year. This year, we have recruited about 200 patients with this sequential approach, and we'll see how it comes out.
So any more questions from the floor?
Luis from Qimei Hospital. Two questions for Dr. Green. One for Yaboyi. Your variable on your slide, your variable, you choose smoking or current smoking or non-smoking. Is there any reason for this kind of group? You are going to analyze the smoking or non-smoking group for this. That's the first question. And the second for females, 4 through 6. I see there's a little difference between the female and the male patient group. And what do you have to demonstrate is a female patient? Is there any sub-analysis or interpretation about gender in this kind of study?
Well, I cannot answer this question. So this is the data on smoking status again. I don't know why it was analyzed here in particular. I don't think it should make a big difference, at least in a cancer like renal cell, maybe in lung cancer. But however, it was presented like that. And with regard to male or female, I don't think there's a good rationale, but these data is always presented. I think it's requested by the authorities which decide about approval of the drug, and that's why it's presented.
Professor Poole.
Yes. Thank you, Professor Green. The case you mentioned that who received EP plus Nivo and who had lung metastasis and liver. Did you discontinue the steroid after all those?
Yeah.
So there are no steroids, there are no immuno-oncology drugs.
No.
And the patient still disease free.
Yes, we have a second case out of 10 we had on the trial. This patient had multiple resections. He had a primary kidney tumor, late recurrence, pulmonary mets, pancreatic mets, which were all resected, and then he had adrenal metastases and also small nodules in the lung where we didn't know whether these are cancer or not, and he had to stop for hypophysitis after 3 dosings, and he's still on corticosteroids because patients who have an endocrine adverse event, the glands just don't work after after hypophysitis, and he needs permanent replacement therapy for corticosteroids. But he's again 3.5 years without any cancer recurrence.
Okay, since we know that immunotherapy plus targeted therapy like IMNN-101 and 426, do you expect FDA or EMA approval of these agents combinations in patients with all risk groups, including favorable?
Well, in the moment, as you saw, the confidence interval for the favorable risk group crosses the border of one, so there's in these smaller, with smaller numbers, it's not significant anymore. I don't know, but I think the drug will get approval for all risk groups, yes.
Thank you.
Since there's a lot of discussion about the biomarker of response, as you reported in your case, IRA, I mean the severity of IRA, would this be a good biomarker of tumor response?
Biomarker of response? Of response?
Yeah.
Well, actually, this is analyzed and has been analyzed. It has been reported in part at ESMO and ESCO-GU. And if you look at the patients who had to stop during the four induction courses with Nivo plus Ipi, the objective response rate is as high as the average. Patients who had all four induction courses and go on Nivo maintenance, they have an even higher response rate. I don't remember the exact number, but it's 50% or plus, a little bit more than 50% objective response rate. So those who get all four doses plus maintenance, they do even better. Those who have to stop, they are on the average what we have for the overall cohort.
Because in the target area, we also used to tell our patient if you have, the severe side effects such as harmful skin or hypertension, then you might have a better response to your treatment. So
yeah.
in the IO era, maybe this is also true.
I'm not an oncologist. I'm a urologist, but as maybe you can answer the question, I think in melanoma something similar has been seen, that patients who have more side effects, they respond better. Yeah.
Any more questions? As a moderator, I have the privilege to ask the next question.
Okay.
So we have known that immune therapy combinations such as the Nivo plus EP can induce more severe immune-related adverse events. So if pembrolizumab in combination with asciminib is approved in Germany, when will you choose the treatment regimen for your patients in first line safety regarding the efficacy and the safety?
You mean between Nivo plus Ipi plus Pembro plus Axi? Well, I think I tried to summarize the advantages on that slide. I think in patients who have a high tumor burden, the benefit of a low intrinsic resistance is treatment guiding. Yeah, because if I don't have time, I think Pembro plus Axi is the right choice. Nivo plus Ipi has the advantage of long-term remissions, and we don't know that now about Pembro plus Axi. And at least with the short follow-up, the complete remission rate of Pembro plus Axi is a little bit less. So in the initial publication of Nivo plus Ipi, it was 9%, here it's now 6%. You can say this is a 3% difference, but you could also say this is a relative 50% difference, so it's a matter of view. And I think the big difference here is the PD-L1 status. As I mentioned, with regard to overall survival, the PD-L1 positive patients had a hazard ratio of 0.45 with Nivo plus Ipi, and this may be an advantage for those patients over Pembro plus Axi. However, if you look at the overall cohort, the hazard ratio of 0.53 is much better than the 0.66 for Nivo plus Ipi, which we have now. So I think we have to wait a little bit for mature data of on overall survival for the Keynote 426. I think the biomarker will play a role. We have to be aware that there are different biomarkers, so the test for PD-L1 positivity with Nivo plus Ipi was a different one compared to the CPS score. One third of the patients in the Nivo plus Ipi study were positive for PD-L1, so it's a selected group and they benefit very much with regard to a high complete remission rate, very good overall survival. The cohort which was PD-L1 positive in the Keynote 426, these were 60% of the patients, so a higher number, not such a, it did not select the patients as much, I would think the biomarker will play a major role in the future, because the benefit is so large with Nivo plus Ipi, but only for selected patients.
Is there any question? The EMA approval for Ipi-Nivo for treatment of RCC, did they consider PD-L1 expression to be essential for patients to use this drug?
No, it's not restricted. Only to intermediate and poor risk, it is restricted, but not by biomarker.
Because of the time of the interest, I would like to I want to conclude this session, and thank you for Professor Green's talk.
Taiwan风城泌尿学会关心您。